In this special episode, iItaly goes to Washington, D.C. to meet Patricia de Stacy Harrison, member of the NIAF Board of Directors and President and Chief Executive Officer of the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Italian Leadership in America is a new series co-produced by iItaly and the National Italian American Foundation.
I'm John Viola, President of the National Italian American Foundation, and we're proud to partner with iItaly to bring you these inside looks into the lives of the Italian Americans of Washington, D.C. Today, we'll sit down with the Honorable Patricia de Stacy Harrison, the CEO of the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a vice chair of the National Italian American Foundation, and one of the more captivating figures here in the nation's capital. It's my honor to introduce Pat Harrison.
Miss Patricia Harrison, thank you very much for being here tonight. And we would like to start with your name, actually, your maiden name, which is the Stacy, but it's not that in Italian, right?
No, it isn't.
What's the story of your name?
My name is really a De Stacio. My uncle Lou was a stockbroker at the very, very early, in the 20s. And at the time, there was a lot of prejudice against Italian Americans. So he changed the name from De Stacio to De Stacy because he felt it sounded French and that would be better. By the time I was born, I didn't even know initially it was De Stacio.
And where did your ancestor came from?
My grandfather was born in Salerno, and my grandmother was born in the United States, but came from the same village in Salerno as my grandfather. My grandfather came to this country when he was 16 years old. And by the time he was 18, he was ready to get married, and someone knew Elisabetta. They got together, they got married, and they settled in Brooklyn. They had seven children. And my grandfather, who was a very big influence on my life, became the unofficial mayor of Bay Ridge because he had a barbershop. And everyone would come into that barbershop. Elected officials from Brooklyn, policemen would come in, and they began to value him. His name was Nunziato De Stacio. He didn't change his name to De Stacy. And they respected him. And more they would come to him. I don't want to make him sound like the godfather of Brooklyn, but they respected him.
You obviously lived in a very Italian neighborhood.
Yeah, well, I actually lived in a Jewish neighborhood, and my grandparents lived in an Italian neighborhood. So we would leave my neighborhood every Sunday
to visit,
to go eat.
That would be Bay Ridge?
Yes, Bay Ridge, Brooklyn. Was very Italian. It was all Italian, Bay Ridge. And so I grew up understanding tradition and how important it was. The only excuse you had for not being at my grandmother's house, where you were dead. That was it. That was the only excuse. You were there every single Sunday. There was music. Everybody smoked. And there was drinks. And I thought they were the most glamorous people on the face of the earth. And I still think that.
What did they tell you about Italy?
I felt that, first of all, that the Italian Americans wanted to do something more than what they had. So they left this beautiful country, but they were always talking about this country in a positive way. They weren't talking about it in a negative way. I did not go to Italy until I was in my 20s, but I had all these stories about family and what it meant. And it was also, they made you feel you had a personal connection to Michelangelo or Machiavelli. My grandfather talked about Machiavelli so much, I thought he was a relative, you know. Yeah. And all the great Italians, it went from opera to, let's say, Perry Como. And every time someone would be on television, you'd be watching television, my father would say, he's Italian. He always told us, even though we already knew this, every single week we had to hear my father say that Perry Como was Italian because he was very proud of it. And Tony Bennett, and Dean Martin, Frank Sinatra, well, Frank Sinatra, of course.
This guy you met, Mr. Harris.
Yeah.
Not being an Italian.
No, he's not. He's How still trying that? To figure me out.
How was it your family reacted to the fact that you were going to marry a non-Italian? How is his family then reacting?
His family, it wasn't so much with his family that I was Italian. It was that I was from Brooklyn. His family was from the South. So being from Brooklyn was like Mars. So when I went to see his family, who lived in Alabama, they would say, this is a fire poker. This is a bowl. The first thing I did, I went onto his back porch, and I thought there were all these feathers in the backyard. And I said, oh, you have chickens. And they were very insulted because it was flowers from a tree. And I thought it was chicken feathers. So I got off to a very bad start. So over a period of time, we got to know one another. And
being an Italian wasn't an issue for them?
No, Brooklyn was the big issue. Being from Brooklyn, New York, and being a northerner, that was the big thing, you know. That scared them more than anything.
And what about your family then in Brooklyn?
Well, you have to meet my husband.
They
thought he was, he's very much like Prince Charles. So they thought he was this nice person. He's very polite. And so we would have our gatherings, you know, our Thanksgiving dinners. And the whole family is there and we're talking a mile a minute. And my husband would be very polite to everyone, but he never got a word in edgewise. I said, you've got to talk more. He said, no one stops. I said, you can't wait for them to stop. I have a sister-in-law who didn't speak for 5 years because we didn't give her an opportunity to say anything. So anyway, everybody eventually got along with everyone and it worked out.
Then you discovered another important part of your life, which is politics.
Yes,
or,
yes.
Know, political interest or involvement. Yeah. How was it that you got to run for co-chair of the Republican National Committee then?
It's so hard to explain this. I was concerned that, first of all, I am a Republican. I was a Republican. And I felt that the party was really needed more women, more people of different backgrounds in the party at the time. And I didn't know anything about the Republican National Committee. I didn't know anything about running for co-chair, but I found out that if you did want to run, you needed 3 people on the committee to just give you permission to sign a thing saying you could run. But I didn't know 3 people. So I had to get a list of people, which took forever to find out who's on this mysterious committee. And then I just picked 3 random people and I got on a plane, I went to meet them and I said, look, if you support me just to run, you don't have to vote for me if I get on the ballot. And they said, well, that sounds fair. And they agreed to that, and I ran, and I won. I really can't explain it. I mean, it was a lot of hard work, and I had to outline what I felt I was going to do, and then I had to do it.
So this was in the 90s?
Yes, it went from 97 to 2000.
So the Republicans were out of power then. But then they won the,
exactly.
the White House.
So
and then
I can,
you went and you had some appointments, right?
Yeah, I can count my 4 years of success because it led to a Republican president. And when that was over, that's when I had an appointment by the president and confirmed by the Senate to become Assistant Secretary of State for Educational Cultural Affairs under Colin Powell.
And how was that experience?
Oh my goodness. It's still an experience because I admire him so much. And in fact, I made him an official Italian-American at a NIAF gala. And
Colin Powell.
Yes, which he was very proud of. He comes from the Bronx, but we allowed it anyway. Any case, working for him was just an incredible experience for me because I learned so much about leadership and management. And I had an opportunity to do things that had an impact that you could really see make a difference. It was a very tense time because it was right after 9/11. And in fact, I was driving to the State Department when the plane was hitting the Pentagon. And I had not been sworn in yet, but I had already been appointed. I was sworn in October. And you just had a complete focus on what your mission was supposed to be.
At that time, you were already involved with NIAF?
Oh, I've been part of NIAF forever. I mean, 25 years, yes. I had to resign when I was assistant secretary, but I worked with NIAF. We brought over young people from a boys' home in Naples to meet with Colin Powell. Half the time he didn't know who we, I would bring so many people from Italy to meet with the secretary, and all for good reasons. And that's when we made him an honorary Italian American at the NIAF Gala.
And other parts of your life and career, which seems important to you and relevant in general, is related to women's empowerment. Mm. You have, I think, written a couple of books on the subject of new women entrepreneurs.
Yes. Or,
why is it that you have this special interest?
I think as we look at both our sons and our daughters, and we look at creating a world where people can live in relative peace, get an education, simple things in life, what disturbs me most of all, as we look at so many countries, when they start with a oppressive regime, the first people they go after are women. And so I couldn't solve all the world's problems, but I could start where I was here in America. And I noticed a trend that more small businesses were being started by women. So eventually I was on the Small Business Advisory Council. I could look at all the research, all the data about women business owners succeeding. So I wanted to write a book about what are the qualities, what does it take to be a successful entrepreneur? And actually, they're the same qualities for men. It has to do with attitude and vision and persistence and confidence, a lot of those things. But with women, getting that self-confidence seemed to be a challenge. And today, it's almost an industry. There's a conference every other 5 minutes on how women can achieve in corporate America or as a successful entrepreneur. But what we haven't solved yet is the ability of women and young girls to have a safe life, and that really is the goal.
You are a successful woman, a leader, and an Italian-American, and I wonder if there are strong women in your family that would have been mentors of your...
My grandmother, who I was very afraid of, and because she always wore black. My grandmother wore black all the time, and my grandfather was afraid of her. She was very strong. That was my kind of, you know, I watched her. My mother was an incredible person who always found a way to do something. if there was a challenge, if there was a problem. She would never let me give up. She would say, you're not thinking enough, go figure it out. And at the time when I was a young girl, when I was, you know, I'd ask her something, do you think I should do this, that, or the other? And her answer was always, use your own judgment. And if I made a mistake, then I'd get in trouble. But I'd say, you told me to use my own judgment. She was extremely creative and never stopped thinking. And so that's someone. And now today I have my own children who are, in many ways, I have two daughters and a son, an inspiration to me. And then when I came to Washington, I met very strong women.
You're a strong woman, and you have strong women in your family. But the role of women in the Italian-American culture has not been like leading, right? But it's supposed to be following the men. You don't seem the kind of woman who does this. So how is your experience in NIAF?
Well, it's interesting because I think if we look inside those families where the men are making speeches and the women are making the coffee, the women are pretty much running the show too, behind the scenes. So the Italian woman is extremely, a very, very strong, strong personality. I don't think I've ever met a weak Italian woman. Nancy Pelosi, this is later in my life. Jean Vena Bell, who is no longer with us. But I was fortunate in my whole career to have people who helped me, or if they didn't really help me, I could watch them. You know, maybe I didn't have a chance to meet them because they were up here and at the time I was over here, but I'd look at them. How do they dress? What do they do? Why are they talking like this? And I just learned so much from watching people. Always curious. This is me on the left and some unknown little boy taken in Brooklyn at Prospect Park. And I heard later that he was the son of refugees from Germany who had escaped the Nazis, and they sent this photo all over the world to the remaining relatives that they had. My first kiss. This is my father, Charles de Stacio, and his father, Nunziato. And at that time, which is, I would say, 1906, this is how Italian Americans dressed their children for a formal photography session. And you can see my grandfather's magnificent mustache. This is my mother, Marguerite, and she is standing at the top of the George Washington Bridge. My uncle was one of the people who helped build the bridge, and he enabled her, quite illegally, I'm sure, to get to the top of this bridge. There's no safety harness, there's nothing. And you can't see it here, but she's in heels. This is the cover of a book I wrote called A Seat at the Table, An Insider's Guide for America's New Women Leaders. These are my three wonderful, incredible children. My oldest is Christopher, and my middle child is Claudia, and my youngest is Courtney. This is a picture of my husband and I am on the board of Meridian, and it's at the Meridian Ball in Washington, D.C. This was a very special occasion, and as you can see, there are many people from the National Italian American Foundation, the CEO of NIAF, John Viola, Charlie Tirano, John LaRosa, Gabe Batista, and Gabe and I are being sworn in at St. Patrick's for us in the red cloaks, very prestigious Order of Francis I, and the other gray cloaks are the Order of St. George, and it was really a very moving, moving experience with Cardinal McCarrick recently.
And then in 2005, you were appointed the president and CEO of the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, right? And it's a position you still hold today.
Yes, I've been there for 10 years. I can't believe it, actually. Hard to believe.
This has been a very important experience in your life, right?
Well, in a way, it's a continuation, when I look back, of everything I've done. Because through public media content, we have an opportunity to really change lives from the youngest citizen to the oldest through our programs that really focus on treating people more than just consumers. We're not trying to sell something.
And we have our own special question in this, which it seems to us that the Italian-American community doesn't take advantage of the opportunities offered by the PBS network.
Well, we have, recently, and it was 5 years in the creation, we funded the Italian Americans, the series. And we heard from so many, in addition to Americans of all backgrounds, because it's telling an immigrant story, so many Italian Americans, some who were watching PBS for the very first time. And the good thing about the Italian Americans is it doesn't have a short shelf life. So you can access it when you want to access it, you can have it, and then there are sidebar things that stations have done. So for example, in New York, they did, as a companion piece, Italian Americans of New York and New Jersey. And that's what a lot of other stations did. So they connected to the Italian American community in a way that wanted people really wanted to know the rest of the story. And the rest of the story is a story of success, of people coming here, working so hard. But the difference was they found joy in the time off they had with their family. If someone came to their home, no matter how poor they were offered food and wine, and I think that's what's passed down. I always wondered, my father always made the pasta in my house. It didn't matter if it was just four people or 14 people. He would use every pot. It would be enough food to feed a neighborhood because he said someone might come by. And I think the lesson we got from those early immigrants to the United States, that no matter how hard it is, we're not going to let the society beat us down. We're going to continue to have our pride and our courage and keep something for ourselves. We are not going to be destroyed by the work, by the hardships. And that's the thing that I think is so valuable, that we have to somehow communicate to a new generation. That it may not be easy, but you have a way to go through it that enables you to emerge as yourself on the other side.
We always end our conversations by asking our guests two special questions to light down the atmosphere. One is, what's your favorite Italian dish?
This is something I could eat over and over and over and over. It's linguine with white clam sauce. Tons of clams.
Can you cook it?
Of course I can cook it. Yes. I make a lasagna that could be used as a murder weapon. It's so heavy. It weighs like 500 pounds. It's got everything in it. And it's really, really good. But you eat it, you go into a coma immediately. But I like linguine and clam sauce.
And then the second question is, what's your favorite Italian song?
Well, it's the first song I ever heard. And I have a photo of my father holding me when I was about 5 months old. And I remember it. And he would sing Come Back to Sorrento in Italian. So that's my favorite song.
Thanks very much, Ms.
Thank
Harrison.
You. I enjoyed it. It's like visiting a psychiatrist. You could charge me.